God's at work, church. Amen. God is on the move. My name is Pastor Chris. I want to just welcome you. Can we just honor and celebrate our choir, man? They did a great job today. And it's amazing seeing such a team. Teamwork really makes the dream work, right? And it's just so thankful for the incredible group of people that make ministry happen here at Evangel, from our pastors to our staff to our deacons and elders and volunteers and leaders. Man, I so appreciate everyone that comes together to serve in many different ways. Wasn't last week fun, Super Sunday? Did you enjoy that? Yeah, that was good. The service was so much better than the game. It was really, really good. It was really good. Yeah, there wasn't a game. Yep. My Steelers still have 6 rings, but the Patriots are catching up. But no, it was a great time, and just it's amazing to see the team come together. I'm so thankful for everyone that served last week to welcome people, and we were packed out here, and just glad that you brought people, friends, neighbors, family, and man, some of you are back this week. Welcome. Can we just welcome back our guests and those that are new here at Evangel? We're so glad to have you with us. We planned a really fun event for today after second service, and it's just for you, and I had no idea. Do you know what yesterday was? National Pizza Day. It was National Pizza Day on February 9th. I had no idea. I didn't eat any pizza. But it's because I was saving my appetite for today after service. We got some pizza. We're going to have a great time. Some of our staff, pastors, and leaders are going to be there. And I hope that you'll be there. If you've been here 6 months or less, come on, I didn't say 6 decades or less. I didn't say 6 years or less. 6 months or less, come over and join us. And man, we just look forward to connecting with you and helping you connect here at Evangel. I'm looking forward to a great time of just getting together and breaking bread and enjoying each other. Right across the hall over there, and I'll see you right after service. And man, I'm just looking forward to what God's doing in this season. I told Pastor Rick as we were going into this series called Stretch Goals, where we are developing goals that are developing our faith. They're growing our faith, helping us to go forward and experience more that God has for us. That's really the word he has over this year, more. And as we're making room for more, we're expanding our capacity. We're preparing ourselves for everything God wants to do in our lives and in our church. So the idea of these stretch goals are goals that develop our faith, as we talked about last week. And as we went through, we have 4 more weeks, including today, of 5 weeks total in the series. But one of the topics that we won't be talking about in the message is about worship. And I talked to Pastor Rick about that. And I said, Pastor Rick, it's not one of the sermon topics, but I need you to take that time we have in worship every Sunday. And can you stretch us as a body? Can you help encourage us to just go further and deeper? And I feel like the Lord's doing that today. I felt like that's really what we began to experience. So thank you, Pastor Rick. I just thank God for you and for the team that God has here. And God's going to grow us in every way. Amen. Are we ready, church? Let me say it again. Are we ready for it? Amen. Well, as we talk about it today, we're going to talk about what it means to stretch in God's word. And, you know, to be able to stretch and truly grow our faith, it's going to require something of us. You know, last week we talked about how to stretch in faith requires us to get out of our comfort zones, to step out of the boat, to step onto the waters, to be in places that will cause us to have to completely rely on God. I want to tell you that as we go through this series, for some of you, for you to be able to stretch into what God has for you, you're going to have to overcome some fear that's been gripping you in your life. And I think one of the biggest areas that if we're really going to stretch and develop and be the people God has called us to be is we're going to have to overcome our own pride. We're going to have to overcome the own pride that's in us. The pride that says, I got this. I know best. I understand the way. Because it's that pride that will sink us. The Bible talks about pride comes before the fall. And those that are prideful, God will bring down. But those who are humble before the Lord, he will rise up. And so we have to approach this saying, Lord, I don't know everything. Because I think especially for today's message, pride is one of the greatest things that gets in our way of experiencing the more that God has for us. You know, we're so advanced today in so many different ways. We're advanced in technology. We're advancing at such an alarming rate. In the 80s, they developed a law called Moore's Law. Have you ever heard of this? It means that technology is now doubling every 2 years. Technology will completely double. So whatever it is right now, 2 years from now, it'll be twice as fast, twice as big, twice as much capacity, whatever it might be. That was in the 80s. Do you think it's still holding up at once every two, doubles every 2 years? No, it's getting faster. The last report I saw said 18 months in technology doubles. It might be even getting closer to a year. Think about it. The phone you had last year and you got the new one this year, twice as fast, twice as much capacity, twice. So technology's doubling. They're finding cures for different kinds of diseases. I mean, we're so advanced. We can see into people's bodies. We can see and develop things and cure disease. I saw a headline that said, within a year, there will be cures for cancer. Did you hear that? That there'd be cures for, there's all this that we're able to do. But here's what I realize, in all of our advancements, in all that we've done as a people and as a world, we can become so prideful that we have this figured out. But there's one area that I've realized that throughout the ages, we have not been able to get right, and it's our heart. I'm not talking about catheterizations and stents and bypasses. I'm talking about the moral condition and fabric of our being. That we still struggle with the same sin, the same brokenness, and as advanced as we've gotten, we still haven't dealt with that issue fully. And there's no amount of knowledge that gets there. There's something that transcends knowledge that can heal and transform a heart. And it's not gonna be found at the end of a microscope. It's not gonna be found in a pill that you take. It's only found by the Spirit of God that can come and move and do this. And so I found that time and again, we can get so advanced, but we can never truly deal with this thing called the human heart. And that's what brings us to a word today that I think kind of sets as a banner over what we're going to be talking about. It's found by the prophet Isaiah in chapter 5, verses 20 and 21. Look what it says. Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who substitute darkness for light and light for darkness, who substitute bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Woe to those, sorrow to those who are wise in their own eyes and clever in their own sight. God, would you speak to us through this word today? Lord, for some of us, we're standing today and we have called what is evil good and what is good evil. And we have replaced the sweetness for the bitterness. And where we have called light darkness and darkness light. And today, Lord God, for some of us, if we're really honest, we have stood and feel as though we are wise in our own eyes, Lord, and perhaps we don't need your instruction. We don't need your guidance because we got this. So, Lord, would you convict our hearts and would you convince us of our reliance on you today? Lord, I'm convinced of it, but I pray that your Spirit will do the convincing in every heart and life. In your name we pray, amen. Amen. For us to understand this passage I just read to you better, we're going to explore the life of three individuals, three kings that served over Israel. And if you have your Bibles, would you open with me to the Old Testament, to the book of 2 Kings? And we're going to actually be going through a few chapters and honing in on a few verses here. We're going to start in chapter 21 of 2 Kings. It's found there in the Old Testament. And you'll find it's one of the accounts of all the leaders that God used to lead his people throughout the ages. And what we find is that what will happen is there'll be a description about that leader and that king. It'll talk about some of the highlights of their life and their work and what they did. But there always seems to be a caveat as to the moral condition of their heart. In fact, you'll see a lot of areas where it'll talk about their accolades. It'll talk about what they built or what they restored or what they did. But sometimes there won't be. They lived and then they died, but it will always speak to what was going on in their heart, because what happened in the heart of that king often translated into the heart of the entire nation. And so that's what we're going to understand today. We're going to look at this idea of what happens when we veer off from the word of God, from his instruction and from his ways, where it can lead us and how we can get back to the core of what God really wants and really honors. And there's just so much God wants to say to us today. And I pray that you'll lean in and just take in everything God has for us. The first king we're going to look at is a king named Manasseh. And he was the son of Hezekiah. And you could read more about Hezekiah if you read earlier in the scriptures there. But we get to Manasseh. He was his son. And Hezekiah was a good king who loved the Lord and who did a lot to honor the Lord. His heart desired to be right before the Lord in many ways. But look at his son Manasseh. Picking up in verse 2, 2 Kings 21. Manasseh did, what was evil in the Lord's sight, following the detestable practices of the pagan nations that the Lord had driven out from the land ahead of the Israelites. He rebuilt the pagan shrines of his father Hezekiah had destroyed. He constructed altars for Baal, which was a god that people worshipped at that time, and set up an Asherah pole, which was another god that they worshipped at that time, just as King Ahab had done in Israel before. He also bowed before all the powers of heavens and worshipped them. That means he was worshiping all kinds of different gods. So there was just a decaying that was happening. But it gets worse and worse and worse. Jump down to verse 6 and look what it says. Manasseh also sacrificed his own son in the fire. He practiced sorcery and divination. He consulted with mediums and psychics. He did much evil in the sight of the Lord, arousing his anger. Verse 7, Manasseh even made a carved image of Asherah and set it up in the temple, in the place of worship of God, in the very place where the Lord told David and his son Solomon, my name will be honored forever. Someone say forever. Forever in this temple and in Jerusalem, the city I've chosen from among all the tribes of Israel. So what's happening here with Manasseh? Manasseh doesn't walk in the ways of his father or the ways that the Lord has put before them. God has given his word. He's given his instruction. He's given clarity so that leaders would not rely on themselves and on their own heart and in trying to be wise in their own eyes. Instead, the Lord has always given them his word and his way and says, here's the way, walk in it. But each king had to make the decision for themselves, just like every one of us has to make a decision in our own lives, regardless of the example that has been set before us, regardless of the home that you grew up in. You have to make a decision, which way will I walk out my life? And so for each king, they made a decision, but the consequences was that whichever way the king went, the entire nation went. It's a great lesson that you may think that you're isolated in the decisions that you're making, but there are people around you that are being influenced, whether you realize it or not. The good things and the bad things, what is right and what is evil. And so these kings feel like, I got this. I'm right in my own eyes. I know what to do. And I can imagine for Manasseh, it starts off innocently. You know, I want to make a good impression. My dad tore down all that stuff. They come asking, yeah, go ahead, set the shrines back up. You can go over there and worship. What's the big deal? It's just a little bit of worship over there. Oh, okay, a new one for Baal? Okay, let's set that one up. Oh, for Asherah? Okay, hey, that looks kind of fun. Let me enter in and worship with them. Oh, okay. Well, you know, it's just my son. I mean, I can have another son. Let me just lay him down. I mean, you see how quickly it starts to slip? Oh, you know what? They're there, but it's too far of a walk. Let's bring them right into the temple and let's worship them right here. We have some space. We have some opportunity. Completely disregarding everything the Lord had said along the way. You know, there's a slow slipping that can happen. And the problem is that we can start to look at it and weigh it with our own eyes, and we can feel like it is fine. It may even feel good because it feels right in our own eyes. But you know that apart from God, we can fall into sin so quickly. Apart from understanding his way and understanding his instruction, we can so easily veer off the path. You know, I was sitting with a family here and they had said, Pastor, we need you to come pray in our house. We feel like something strange is going on. And so we were praying, talking, going over things and had prayed. And one of the people in the family, one of the children was really gripped with fear and feeling a lot of strange things. And so we had prayed and left. I felt peace as I left and believed that they would as well. And I said, you know, just continue to seek the Lord and love the Lord. They love the Lord, been, you know, baptized here, walking with the Lord. And then came a couple weeks ago and we're here and said, how you doing? I said, oh, not great. You know, we got to talk. I don't feel good again. Things don't feel good. And I don't feel peace and whatever the case is. And I said, okay. So we're talking a little. And I said, is there anything you're not telling me that you're doing? Anything you're not telling me just I sense something was off. She said, well, I do have this book of Wicca that I read from and pray from. I said, what? She said, no. I said, no, that's not good. She said, no, it's no big deal. The person that gave it to me told me it's you know, it's fine, it's nice. I said, the reason you're telling me you're feeling this way is because you've now tried to engage in something. She said, oh, should I get rid of it? Yeah, yes. We're gonna get rid of it. We're gonna pray, we're gonna get rid of it. But I just look back at this and I think, you know what? We could say, whoa and wow, but guess what, man? If I sit with you long enough and we sit together, we're gonna learn some same things and we'll say, wow, whoa, what? Because in our own hearts, if we don't have something to measure it against, it seems so innocent. Is anyone with me? Come on, man, we've made decisions. We've been there. We think, whoa, what happened? And to someone else, it would be, what? But it just slips. Manasseh, written all over it. You with me? So we see it just a generation away from abandoning God's words and leaning away. I'm thankful, even for that one that I prayed with, like believing God for just complete freedom and just a complete holding on to the Lord. But there's subtle ways that if we don't just stay rooted, we can be led astray into those kinds of things. So we have Manasseh, but then after Manasseh, he has a child. He has a child named Amon. So say Amon. And Amon was another king who did evil in the eyes of the Lord. And in fact, it says before that about Manasseh, it says the people refused to listen to the Lord, and Manasseh led them to do more evil things than even the pagan nations the Lord had destroyed. He murdered Manasseh. Let me go back to Manasseh in verse 16. He murdered many innocent people until all of Jerusalem was filled with innocent blood. This was in addition to the sin that caused the people of Judah to commit, leading them to do evil in God's sight. Here's what I find, that when you begin to remove the word of God, God's standards, God's way, God's wisdom, God's insight, when you start to say, yeah, but, and push that all aside, there is a decaying that happens among the people. There's a decaying that happens. If you look at any group of people, you look at any nation, the further it gets from the word of God, from God's ways, you will begin to see a moral decay, and people say, everything is all right, no problem. It seems right. It seems okay. And then you're looking, you say, this is craziness. What's going on? This is what's happening in Manasseh's day. I wish I could say that with all our technology and all our advancements, we've gotten this thing right. But you know I'd be lying to you today. That we can be in just the same positions. That we can see just the same things happening. That we can say it's not a big deal, but it is a big deal. Because of what it's doing to us, to our hearts, to our brokenness. Sin is a big deal to God. And it's a big deal whenever we walk in a way that doesn't honor the Lord. And so after Manasseh passes, he has a son named Amon. And you can find out about him as you read a little further down at verse 19 of 2 Kings 21. It says, Amon was 22 years old when he became king, and he reigned for 2 years. Someone say 2 years. That's short. That's very short. And as he reigned, he did what was evil in the Lord's sight, just as his father Manasseh had done. He followed the example of his father, worshiping the same idols his father had worshiped. Isn't it amazing to see how much of an influence we can see passed down from one generation to another? That for some of us, we can see that. You can see the same things just kind of showing up in your family over and over and over again. Can I tell you something? That today as we worshiped and we prayed, because of the power of what Jesus has done on the cross, you don't have to walk in the same way that your family did. You don't have to be an alcoholic because your dad was an alcoholic. You don't have to be a drug addict because someone in your family was a drug addict. You can break the cycle because in the name of Jesus, there's power to break every chain. That's what we're talking about. This gets very real very quick, right? But we can see if it goes unchecked, same things his father had. Were passed down. And here's what gets worse, is that he doubles down on it in many ways. He did what was evil in the Lord's sight. He worshiped the same idols. Ready? He abandoned the Lord. So for Manasseh, he tried to worship God and all the other idols, but it says his son then completely shuts the door on the Lord and just stays over here with everything else. Isn't it amazing? You're one generation away from seeing what one tolerated, the other now completely gives themselves into and completely shuts the door to the Lord. It says he refused to follow the Lord's ways. He lasted 2 years. Man, sometimes whenever that happens, we keep pushing, pushing against God, running from God, pushing into our own thing, and eventually the grace just lifts. You know, this is a man who thought that he could lead the people of God and yet completely be unyielded to God, completely turn away from him, completely do this. And because of that, there was no repentance in his heart. There was no acknowledgement of his sin. Within 2 years, he was gone. But think about that. 22 years old, 2 years later, he's gone. And there's a young boy who's 8 years old named Josiah. And the whole kingdom gets left in the hands of a young boy who's 8 years old. But sometimes what we need is a young boy who's 8 years old, whose heart can get right with God, to change and flip the whole equation. He became the youngest king to ever serve in Israel's history. And I want you to know this message and this passage is such a special place in my heart, because my wife and I, we prayed for a child for a long time. And we prayed, and we sometimes even had some struggles to get pregnant. But we knew as we prayed that God was bringing us a son named Josiah. And we prayed it, and we prayed for him, and then we were pregnant, and then Lily was there. It was a girl. I'm thinking, it's not Josiah Fien, it's Lily. So we're praying, but we were making room for Josiah. We were just praying, and it wasn't as if, are we going to one day have a kid? It's like, when's Josiah coming? Like, when are we going to? And when we were pregnant, we thought, we think this is him. And then we went and checked, it was a boy. I said, there he is, that's Josiah. And so this means a lot to us, but his name is so significant because his name, our prayer, what we prophesy over him, we speak over him, is this, that he would be a young man in the midst of a broken world that will just love the Lord and with everything in him, just bring people to the word of the Lord and just lead that. So we pray that over our son. And I encourage you, if you pray for me, pray that over him and my children as well. But this Josiah, 8 years old, about to turn the whole world upside down, about to turn hearts back to the Father. It says he was 8 years old when he became king. Chapter 22, verses 1 through 7. He reigned in Jerusalem for 31 years. He did, verse 2, what was pleasing in the Lord's sight. And he followed the example of his ancestor David. He did not turn away from what was doing right. His heart was to do what was right. He wanted, with everything in him, to honor God. And he had an example of David who went before him, and he wanted to follow that example. In verse 3, in the 18th year of his reign, King Josiah sent Shepham and his grandson to the court, and the court secretary to the temple of the Lord, and he told them, go to Hilkiah, the high priest, and have him count the money the gatekeepers have collected for the people at the Lord's temple. Entrust the money to men assigned to supervise the restoration of the Lord's temple. So do you want to see how far decayed things had become? Take a look at this passage. Two generations away from honoring the Lord, worshiping the Lord, having a place of prominence for God's word and instruction, now the temple's in decay and disrepair and needs to be restored. So Josiah says, you know, if we're going to honor God, if we're going to love God, then the temple, the place that my grandparents, great-grandparents used to worship the Lord, should be restored. So let me take the funds that have come in. We're going to stop spending them on whatever we're spending. We're going to restore the temple. We're going to restore the place of worship. It will be beautiful again. So he said, begin to pay all the people to do that. Pay the workers to repair the temple. Hire everyone that you need to hire and trust the people that they're going to do good work. So they get there and they're doing it. Look at verse 8 with me of 2 Kings 22. Hilkiah the high priest said to Shepham and the king's secretary, and the court secretary, I have found the book of the law in the Lord's temple. And then Hilkiah gave the scroll to Shepham and he read it. This was the first time among the people they had rediscovered God's word. Do you want to know what the first thing to go was whenever Manasseh started to turn away? It was God's word and his law. Then everything else fell. They're still using the temple, and then they started to use the temple for the wrong things. But it starts, the moral decay of the fabric of a society begins and ends with the word, with God's way, with God's instruction. It's so important and so vitally important. And so we see they discover it again. And when they discovered it again, it was like a light went on. But why was it buried there in the first place? You know, I think about this. My wife and I have been doing a lot of work and a lot of cleaning. It's not spring yet, but we wanted to get a heads up on spring cleaning. So I've been tackling my basement like crazy, sorting through stuff and throwing away stuff. And man, there's a lot of stuff buried in my basement. Does anyone have a room like that? That there's stuff, and when you go and you find it, you thought, wow, at one point in time, I thought this was so necessary, and it's become so irrelevant to me, and it doesn't bring me joy, so I'm going to get rid of it now, right? But there's things that you find. Here's what I promise you, if you go and you do this, here's what you will not find buried in your basement, this cell phone right here that you carry in your pocket, your car keys, your remote control, come on, someone, unless you got a new one already. You won't find your computer that you use for work buried there. You won't find your briefcase buried there. You won't find the shoes that you wear every day buried there. You'll find the things that are irrelevant there. And when you find them, they will have collected tons and tons of dust. Here's what I'm telling you today. God's word was buried in the middle of the temple, not in the hearts of the people as it should have been. It was collecting dust because it was irrelevant to them. Here's a problem that I think the same thing has happened in many Christian circles as well. That the word of God is collecting dust. We get together, we come here and say, hey, you talked a word about me, so I don't have to open this thing up for myself during the week. Let me come and let me get hungry and get fed. And now if I'm not getting fed the way I want to get fed, I'll go to a different buffet down the street. I'll get fed. Say, it's never been the job of the church to feed you. We're here, we're just here to sprinkle something on to supplement what you're already being fed with every single day. But we get into this weird, crooked way of thinking. Think we're going to be sustained by the word of God because I've opened it for 35, 40 minutes with you once a week? Try eating for 40 minutes for once a week. You can eat as much as you want. If I just put a buffet here for you and say, go, eat, 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 you could stuff yourself till you're sick, but you will be malnourished and starving if you continue to live that way. Say, I'm coming here and I'm eating, but don't eat anything during the rest of the week. If the same thing's happening for the word, our daily bread, his sustenance, his life, what he has for us, is it collecting dust? You know, some of us, we have the word of God literally at our fingertips now. You can download an application. You can watch it. For some of us, we have it there, but the very app has collected dust. Everywhere else on your phone screen is fine, but that app. I told my wife on the Bible app, that's where I read daily from, they have something called streaks, which is whenever you're reading consecutive days in a row. They should call something called creaks, that when you press it after a long time, it'll creak open real slow. Like dust will kind of come up on your screen, like, welcome back. Come back and lean into the word. You with me? I'm going to write to them. I got their customer service line. But when the word becomes buried in collecting dust, we're doing what we think is right in our own eyes. We sang about it. We talked about it. But it's not enough, family. It's not enough to sustain us. It's not enough to stretch us. It's not enough to grow us. It's not enough to experience the more that God has for us. See, for them, they didn't find a book. They said, we found the book of the law. But you know what they realized as they began to read it? They found a way of life. They found a relationship with God again. This is what will happen. If you think the Bible is just a book, you're so mistaken. It's a way of life. It's the Father's heart. It's a way for you to live in the relationship and understand the depths of what he's done for you. When you find it to be just a book, you're limiting it. The Bible says the word itself testifies about itself. In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, it says, the word of God is living and active. It is sharper than a double-edged sword. It penetrates deep to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow, and it judges the thoughts and attitudes of our hearts. Isaiah says that the grass will wither and the flowers will fade, but the word of our Lord will endure forever. It is ever relevant. It is as relevant today as it was the day God had it written down. It is as relevant today as it was to Josiah when they discovered it in the temple. God's word is life. It's alive. And he wants to say something to you through it every single day. So in verse chapter 22, verse 9, it says that Shechem went to the king and he started to report. He said, we have found the book of the law in the temple. And he said, it brought you this scroll. In verse 11, when the king heard it and what was written in the book of the law, whenever he was reading it, he began to tear his clothes in despair. This was the king who loved the Lord. This was the king of the Bible says he followed the example of David. He looked around and tried to find the best people that love God and tried to follow them. But here's what happens. That will only get you so far. You need his word living and active in your heart. You can be around Christians all you want. You can be a part of ministry teams here. But if you don't have the word, you'll stand in a place and when you're confronted with it, you'll tear your clothes. You'll say, no, I missed it, Lord. You had something more for me. Do you know what was happening here? It's something that's called conviction. God's word comes and the Holy Spirit uses it and it convicts us. That sounds like a bad word to so many, but I want to promise you it's not. When we think about the word conviction, you need to replace it with the word convincing. Because when we're being convicted, we're being convinced of something. We're being convinced of something right or convinced of something wrong, but it's really the Lord himself by the power of his Spirit putting his finger on something in your life. You don't have to be afraid of conviction. Welcome it because the word of God comes and it provides this convincing within you. This is right or this is wrong. And here's what I'm so thankful for is when God puts his finger and we say, this is wrong, then you can turn it to the Lord, ask for his forgiveness and grace, turn from it. And the Bible says he's faithful and just to forgive you of all your sin. So we don't have to be afraid to lean into that and say, Lord, convict my heart of sin. Convict me, Lord, if what I'm doing, how I'm living, what I'm entertaining, what I'm doing, if it is sin, Lord God, then convict me of it. Because it doesn't just have the power to convict, it has the power to cleanse. I thought I'd get a better response for that. Bible says, though my sin is like scarlet, you wash me white as snow. His word, when we turn to his word and say, Lord, I'm just going to honor what you say here. You say to do it in your word, Lord, I'm going to honor you. And the word of God has a cleansing effect in our lives. It points out what's right and what's wrong, and then it helps us to confront those things by the power of his Spirit. And ultimately, Jesus is the only one that forgives. And when we bring that to him and honor him and ask, he forgives us and leads us forward. But there's a startling effect that the word can have. And it reminds me of when we were cleaning the basement, we finally got one of the rooms cleared out. We were putting up some shelves and I looked there and I thought, man, I can't even see what's on the shelves. There's all these shadows and everything's kind of dark. And I thought, man, I got to do something about that. So I was at the store and I thought I got to buy a light bulb. One of the light bulbs burnt out and I looked and I saw the 60 watt and then I saw the 100 watt. I thought, let me get the 100-watt bulbs. So I got the 100 watts, I brought them home, and I unscrewed the ones that were there, 40 watts. So you know what happens when you go from 40 watts to 100 watts. I screwed these two in, and Mandy walked in, she was like, whoa, the white walls, and said, that's bright. I said, but you can see everything in the shelves now, and you can see back there, and you can even see inside your skin like an X-ray almost. It's very bright in that room. But I said, but it's good, because now we can see the things that were hidden away in the corners. Are you with me? The word has the same impact in our lives. It says, your word, Lord, is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. It illuminates the way. It says, this is the way. Walk in it. You don't have to wander in darkness anymore. For me, when I was a new Christian, Pastor Rick, you can come on up. When I was a new Christian, I didn't know what was right. I tried to do what was right in my own eyes. I wanted to be a good person. But here's what I learned when I met Jesus. Good isn't good enough. Good in my own strength is like filthy rags compared to Jesus and what he's done for me. It just isn't enough. As much as I'd want. So when I came to Jesus, I said, Lord, I want to live my life to honor you. And then I found, how can I do that? How can I know what to do? His word. I started to read it. I was like, I don't understand what some of this stuff means. But then I started to understand some of it. And I started to memorize some of it. I started to remember some of the verses. I'd read them over and over again. And I thought, yeah, that's good. I need that. Let me read that. Let me memorize that. And I still have, this is the first Bible I received after I got saved for my birthday. And my friend Jesse gave it to me. And I still have highlights in here from when I was just a teenager, just trying to figure this out. Just trying to figure out what it meant. And when I read something and I thought it was good, I would try to memorize some of it. And with that, you know, God was just doing a transformative work in my heart. I promise you, when God's word takes a priority in your life, it starts to change everything. And that's what has to happen for us if we're gonna stretch and grow and become everything God wants us to be. And so I wanna do something today. I wanna give you a few things that are gonna help you grow in the word of God. I want you to take on the end of your row, there's a basket with some cards in there at the right-hand side. If everyone will reach to the right-hand side of your row and just begin to pass those down. And everyone pull one out, grab a pen if there's one in there or in front of you. And every week you're gonna have an opportunity to stretch in some area. And today it's about stretching in God's word. And if you'll just turn to the back, I want you to know that in your desire to know God better through his word, we want to help equip you in every way we can. And one of the ways that we're going to do that, you're going to see three things on the back here that are special resources. And you can find more resources by going to that website. Later this week, we'll have a bunch more resources on there for you to kind of get plugged in and continue to grow in your faith. But the first thing is called Right Now Media. How many of you know about Netflix? Anyone have Netflix? God, you're so much more honest than the first service. They thought they were too holy for Netflix. I knew they had it. I knew they were watching Hulu. They might have been watching it during the message and they felt convicted. But here's what's cool about Right Now Media. Take the idea of Netflix and add it to Christian Bible study. It's 14,000 videos, Christian Bible study, word studies, all kinds of stuff. And it's free for you today. We've made it free for the entire church. Everyone that calls Evangel Home, you get a free subscription to it. So we're excited to give that to you. It's going to help you grow. And just to tell you a little bit more about it, I want to show you this video so you can really understand the depth of what's available to you.
Our church is a light in the darkness, a city on a hill. Every believer is called to make a difference in the world, to love God completely, and to make disciples of every nation. But in this busy, mobile, noisy world, it can be difficult to even do the basics, to pray, to read the Word, to bring the love of God to our marriages, families, neighbors, and co-workers. We know you're here because you want to be a part of God's mission on the earth. You want to experience the abundant life that Scripture talks about. You're looking to connect your faith to every part of your life, every day of the week. That's why our church is subscribing to Right Now Media and making it available for free to every member of our church. You'll have access to over 10,000 online Bible study videos on parenting, marriage, finance, discipleship, leadership, and many more. The videos can be used in Bible study groups or for personal devotion. There's also a huge library of safe biblical kids videos. We'd love to see every member of our church utilizing Right Now Media. Small group leaders leading their adult or youth groups through engaging Bible study series. Children enjoying safe programming that doesn't just entertain, but helps lay a strong spiritual foundation. Families spending quality time together, going through devotional Bible studies. Couples using biblical studies on marriage, parenting, and finance. Applying God's Word to every area of their lives. There is something for everyone. We want to help you grow as a disciple of Christ, and we want to help you become a disciple maker in your home, your school, your workplace, your neighborhood, in whatever mission field God has called you to. We believe that this free resource will help equip and unleash you to live out your faith in every area of life, to experience God-centered, abundant life, not just on Sundays, but every day. We are for you, and God is for you. He wants to empower you every day to live for Him. Together, we can be a light in the darkness, a city on a hill.
Amen. So again, if you're a part of Evangel here, if you've been attending, and even if you're brand new, it's fine. We want to make this available to everyone that calls Evangel home, and it's a free resource for you. So here's how you can take advantage of that. There's a card that's right in front of you. Hold on to that card. Begin to fill it out. And this card is a commitment before the Lord. But before you fill that out, as you just look at it, I want to read something to you. This is what the Lord really spoke to me about when I look at the story of Josiah. It says in 2 Kings 23, verses 2 and 3, it says, "The king went up to the temple of the Lord, and with all the people of Judah and Jerusalem, along with the priests and the prophets, all the people from least to the greatest. And the king read aloud the entire book of the covenant that had been found in the Lord's temple. And the king took his place of authority beside this pillar. He renewed the covenant in the Lord's presence, and he pledged to obey the Lord by keeping all his commands, his laws and decrees with all his heart and soul. In this way, he confirmed the terms of the covenant that was written on the scroll, and all the people pledged themselves to the covenant." Here's what I want to invite us to do today, that in God's presence, would you be willing to enter into a covenant with the Lord? Say, "Lord, I'm going to honor your word. I'm going to make your word a priority in my life moving forward." And so if you're willing to do that, this is what you're going to sign on this card. I put your name there. Commit to reading more of God's word by, and there's a few options I've given you here. Reading God's word daily, spending time with him every single day. Reading through the entire New Testament in 90 days. We're going to send you a reading plan if you'd like to help you read through the entire New Testament, second half of the Bible in 90 days. Or just as I'm doing, read through the entire Bible in 2019, 20 to 25 minutes a day, and you could read through the entire Bible this year, even if you start today and start now. And the other one, there's other options if God's put something else in your heart. The one I would encourage is for you to begin the discipline of memorizing scripture. To really begin to say every day, some of you, if you read here and there, you see a verse that you like, take that verse for the day and say, "By the end of today, I'm gonna know this by heart." Set it somewhere and just keep reading it over and over and over again. Commit it to memory, because when God's word is in your heart, it comes up. The Holy Spirit brings it to recollection and remembrance. And so as you fill that out, you sign it, put the date there, and that's for you. On the bottom part, I want you to sign it and date it and put the same thing that you're committing to do, but we need your email address so that we can send you Right Now Media, and we can send you the other resources we'd like to give to you. So you're gonna fill that bottom part off, and in just a second, the ushers, you can come forward now. They're gonna come, and then you're just gonna drop that in. We're gonna take up an offering today. This isn't a financial offering. It's an offering of your heart before the Lord to say, "Lord, I'm gonna place a priority on your word. I'm gonna place a priority on honoring you, Lord, and stretching in your word this year." So I'm gonna pray, and then after I pray, I want you to finish filling this card out, tear it off just like this, and just drop it in the offering. So let me just pray right now as we're preparing our hearts. Lord Jesus, we come before you. We thank you that you are the word that became flesh and dwelt among us. We thank you that you have now allowed by the power of your spirit, your word to be written on our hearts, that we could walk in a way that pleases you. But Lord, today we need to dust off, Lord God, your word. We need to become more fully engaged daily, Lord God, in the provision of what you've given to us. May it be life-giving. Lord, we commit ourselves and stretch ourselves this year, Lord God, for more of you. And Lord, we commit all this now, this covenant with you in your presence. In Jesus' name, amen.